And hello, Podders! Welcome to episode 37 of CosPod, the podcast for all things cosplay. If this is your first time listening to us, welcome. We are a fairly zany podcast, that's putting it mildly, by cosplayers for cosplayers. And we are watched and listened to around the world, and we've heard from some pretty cool people that enjoy cosplay, and so we hope to bring some of that to you. We have a packed show for today. A really, really packed show. More than normal.
Understatement.
and it will not, in fact, be full of talking this time, as with the past couple of episodes. We're actually going to be showing you a little bit of stuff, as we are focusing entirely on competition and cosplay, and that is in honor of the massive wave of conventions that is coming up in the next month. Which is also an understatement. I think there's...
Too many!
There's major conventions, not just for us, but, you know, around the nation and around the world, every weekend for the next many, many,
many, many months. It's basically full-on con season now.
Yes, yes, we are in con season. And speaking of con season, I believe you just came from one.
Yeah, I literally...
I know I'm a little out of order, but that's okay.
No, we're about right. Well, we're close. We'll be out of order. I don't care.
We'll do the other thing afterward.
As of 4 hours ago, I came back from a convention in the area. It was Dallas Comic Con. Yay! Which somebody posted the attendance was 60,000 people. I hope to God that was really not the real number. There is no way 60,000 can fit in that little convention center. But this year they moved it over from a two-day to a three-day convention. It's only been around for a couple of years. I only went Saturday and today Sunday. It was packed. It was really flippin' humid. It was really windy. There were a lot of lines. I was so depressed yesterday. I was so exhausted. Even better is that the escalators broke down. For those who have never been to this convention center, there's really one way up, the escalator. There are a set of stairs, both indoors and outdoors. However, because they wanted to control the crowds, they wouldn't permit anyone to use any of the stairs, which seems like a giant fire hazard, I know. So when they finally got the escalator working again about an hour and a half after the convention center opened up, they had to shuttle people up in small groups of no more than 10 people. So basically, if you were on the ground floor, if you wanted to get upstairs for any of the autographs or you wanted to see any of the celebrities, if you wanted to do any of the panels, you had about a three-hour wait. Yippee. So I basically spent all day Saturday just walking on the first floor in circles and in lots of circles and in even more circles. Got to see everything and then some in the dealer's room, which was awesome. I took lots of cosplay photos, and it just ended up being giant hangout day with other cosplayers, because really going upstairs was just not going to happen. But today was the day when everybody kind of calmed down. There's less people because, of course, it's Sunday. Sunday's usually the slow day. So I took advantage of the fact that it was slow, didn't really wear a costume, just kept it sort of casual. I was able to actually go upstairs and meet some of those celebrities I've been meeting to, like the Green Ranger. Yay! The voice of Batman. Double yay! And then like three people from the Next Generation from Star Trek. Triple yay! And really, just today was about relaxing, having fun again. So it was a joy. I'm sure they're going to hear a lot of complaints about the traffic flow. Probably not just from me, but from other people as well. But I know that they tried their best.
You know, that happens at conventions sometimes.
Oh, yeah. I think this was definitely breakdown in communication, because it seemed so ridiculous to me that it's like, okay, the escalators are broken. Huge fire hazard that you won't let people take the stairs. You got to open up the stairs, people. Come on. So I'm sure they're going to get a lot of flack for that. But I still had fun. I still enjoyed myself, and I'll still go back next year, of course. Especially
so
if they bring Nathan Fillion. Oh, totally worth it. Nathan Fillion, unfortunately, had to cancel, who was my main reason for going this weekend. Otherwise, I wasn't even going to bother. He got sick, and he canceled.
You would probably rather him stay away if sick than to be patient zero, especially if you're a celebrity at a con. Oh, so you want to get famously sick?
Yes. If it's Nathan Fillion, yes. He's on my list. I don't care.
Oh my.
He's my path.
No comment.
Hi, boyfriend. But yes, I will totally go back next year, and I'm sure that they'll make adjustments like they always do.
Of course. And I know you had been working on a costume really hard for that con, too.
Yeah, I got Raven done. Woohoo!
Do you like my segue?
It was a nice little segue. I was going to say, actually, I've just finished uploading all the photos for it from Flickr. I'm going to be posting them onto our Facebook page after we're done recording tonight. So if you're looking for images, just check our Facebook after this, guys, and we'll have them up. But yes, I did have Raven done for it. I was surprised how many people stopped me because I thought, you know, Teen Titans is slowly dying down. No one's really going to care. Dude, my friend that is Starfire and myself, we caused like a circle for a good 20 minutes in the dealer's room where we just didn't move. I was constantly being asked for photos, and I was just like, okay, this is weird. I haven't had to experience this in a really long time. Because we're both in the same boat. We technically do typically do a lot of like obscure characters or things that are very rarely cosplayed. So I'm like, that's Raven. Most people cosplay her. I've seen quite a number of them. I guess it's just a compliment that I did my costume so well. That's the only thing I can really think of.
There you go. Sometimes all it takes is the little things.
Yeah, I guess so. I have nothing else going on as far as what's coming up, though. I have to remake my boots for Celeste from Final Fantasy VI yet again, and I can show you what happened. The humidity happened. All of my paint, for the third time, chipped off, so I'm having to strip this thing and start from scratch. I got to get it done before Wednesday. I don't think it's going to happen. So what have you been working on?
Speaking of paint, lots and lots and lots of fabric paint. Since last episode, I finished UA.
Yay!
Goodness, it's finally done. The EL wire keeps pulling itself up off the bow in places periodically just to make sure I'm paying attention. And so far I have been paying attention and judiciously using E6000 in place of super glue. And if that doesn't hold, I don't know what will. Aside from that, I basically threw together a really terrible set of belts for Deedlit. And I say terrible because it's not up to my standards and not what I'm capable of doing, but most of that is due to budget and time. It will work for the con, though. And I put together a pair of suspender straps for Umi so that I can wear thigh-high boot covers and not worry about having them fall down perpetually. Because I don't want to choke off my circulation by putting elastic around the top of the thigh. And the paint is from Erza Scarlet from Fairy Tail, and I have been frantically painting a castle-style border. For those who don't know, castle is the kind of square, boxy-looking thing that looks like the top of a castle tower. And I've been painting that with a lot of fabric paint. And it takes a lot of time. I woke up this morning a little before 8, and I basically started painting almost as soon as I got up and threw glasses on until about a half an hour ago, minus a little bit of time for grocery shopping. But otherwise, I've pretty much been painting all day. And I got most of the first layer done. And that was it. Which doesn't sound like a lot, but, you know, it's almost 36 inches long. And it's probably 16 inches high. So it's a lot of paint. And hopefully I will have this costume done in time for A-Kon, because I know there's a couple of Fairy Tail cosplayers who were really excited about getting a group together. And I was like, yay, group cosplay for the first time outside of Slayers. I want to do this.
Outside
I want to be
of
part
me.
Of... Yes, well, that wasn't quite a group, like, planned. It wasn't planned as a group. It just kind of happened that way.
It just kind of happened that way. But you got to admit, it was fun.
Yes, it was a blast. But this is more of a planned group.
Yes.
It's like, okay, I really want to do this. I really like the character. I'm going to throw a costume together last minute, which I hate doing, but I'm going to do it anyway, just because I have time.
Oh,
and
I
like the character. So it's like, okay. So I have been living and breathing fabric paint for the last 2 days. And I actually took a 4-day weekend. I have the next 2 days off because this is my mental me time because I'm now done with school until, you know, June 15th. So this is kind of Amber's celebratory, you know, do whatever the heck she wants time. So that's what I'm spending my 2 days doing is throwing together an Heirs of Scarlet costume. This is how I spend my free time. I make cosplay.
I nearly forgot. I did finish one thing because I'm a weirdo about my accessories. I got my snake done.
And what is the snake's name?
We decided to name him Sigmund Freud. We think it's very appropriate considering the character. I realize it's stupid and he has eyelids. I know snakes do not have eyelids. I don't care. It makes me smile. It's so stupid. I love it.
He has personality.
He has a lot of personality for being named Freud, yeah. I'm a dork. I'm one of those people where I like to make accessories that make a character stand out that are completely unique. I do it with, especially with my Ace Attorney cosplays, I am such a dork about my accessories. Because I've seen Dahlia Hawthorne's who just do just the umbrella and all that stuff, but I actually make the little necklace with the little vial on it, and yeah, I like my accessories that nobody else will do. So he's my accessory. Great.
You know, sometimes the accessory just makes the costume. And that's really all that matters.
This one will.
Yes. Yes, it probably will.
Evil cackle.
That was like the most quaint evil cackle ever. Just saying.
Oh, man.
But anyways, why don't we move on to our main topic?
Yeah, let's do that.
Because this episode's going to go long anyway, so we may as well at least, you know, be somewhat productive while we're at it.
I was being productive. I was talking about my snake.
/ sarcasm, ma'am. Anyways.
Anyway.
Basically, we're going to cover competition in three parts. We're going to start with the run-up, basically how you prepare for it. Then we will go into what you actually do when you're up on stage and or having photos taken of you as a competitor. And then we'll close out with the judging portion of it, which that's going to be all you.
Whee!
So okay. Why don't we start with prepping for it? How do you prep for competition? One of the first things that you should do after you decide, you know, what character you're going to do and you've entered, you know, signed up to enter the competition, given them all your information and such, is to start taking pictures of what you're doing.
Every AKA, single time.
AKA a portfolio in the industry speak. Basically, it's just documentation of how you made the costume. I'm waiting for you to jump in because I know this is a favorite topic of yours. I believe you have a panel on it.
I can say I berated her on making sure she takes as many photos as possible for her recent costumes because she's horrible about this. And
I admit to having been really lax on UA, and I blame it entirely on school. So I do have a valid excuse. But yes, do as I say, not as I do.
There we go.
Take pictures showing how you made the different parts of your cosplay, especially if it's not going to be blatantly obvious how you made it, if you stand up in front of somebody that's judging you, prejudging, normally. So if it's not, you know, eminently obvious that I cast this myself out of resin, then you need to show that you cast it out of resin, if in fact you did. If you purchased it, you know, that's not necessarily something you have to document as thoroughly. But if it's something you did, take credit for it. You know, tell them, I did this, and here's how I did it. You don't have to be really detailed. Like, you don't have to show daily progress on your costume, and or you don't have to say exactly how many stitches are in this particular scene.
God, please do not do that. We will get pissy at you. Throw things.
You want to be detailed enough to get your point across, but not so detailed that their eyes glaze over as they're reading it, because then they're just going to basically write off the rest of what you said.
We're basically jumping ahead to portfolios now.
Well, the portfolio itself is, you know, part of the process for prepping, because you have to make the portfolio first. In portfolios, as you're making them, make sure that you include reference pictures of what it is you're cosplaying, because not everybody is going to know what the heck you are.
Mm-hmm.
Especially if they are not an anime fan, say at an anime convention, if it's a guest judge, or, you know, at a sci-fi competition, if you happen to be, say, cosplaying a comic character from an obscure comic, they may not know who you are, and you shouldn't necessarily get mad at them for that either, just saying. So just, you know, have a reference shot comparing, you know, what it's supposed to look like as to what your costume actually looks like. Can you think of anything else specifically in the making of the costume?
In the making of the costume, try to keep track of what materials you're using and try to keep in mind what type of stitches that you're doing. I know those seem like really little things, but they can actually make a big difference between someone thinking, oh, you bought this costume, and oh, you really made it yourself. Sometimes those little details do come into question, and it's good to know what you're working with and how you're working with it.
Good segue to craftsmanship. A lot of conventions now have a specific craftsmanship award, and if that's something that you decide you would like to go for, and I recommend that you decide early if that's something that you want to do rather than late.
Late.
because craftsmanship is judged very closely,
mm-hmm.
as in like literally a couple inches in front of your face, so they will see each and every mistake that you've made, even if you don't tell them you've made it. Some of them are very visible. And also, a lot of conventions are getting a lot better about having fashion design majors or theater costuming majors
mm-hmm.
do the judging. So they're very knowledgeable people. So you need to make sure that if you're going in for craftsmanship judging, you need to finish off all your seams. You need to make all your edges clean, whether they're, you know, hems or seams. You need to make sure that everything is neat. There's no fraying. You need to make sure that any cast gems have been sanded smooth so that there aren't any burrs on them. Basically, you need to have your costume look as professional as possible if you are going for craftsmanship. If you're basically just going for overall effect, then you may be able to, I don't want to say cheat, because it's not cheating, skip over some of the more detailed parts of the costume, like doing a Hong Kong finish. And you don't have to worry so much about that. The judges won't necessarily look for those sort of things if that's not what you're going for. But if it is, then you need to have the time to do it properly, because they'll know.
It also depends on the contest, too, because, I mean, in something like A-Kon, where a lot of that is just about the show, even though they're doing a craftsmanship portion this year, the big bulk of that is going to be, how does your piece look on the stage, even if it's duct taped on the inside, because they don't really care. But then there are other places like Costume Con where it's all about the craftsmanship. So it's not about, does it look really pretty on the outside? They care about what your seams look like on the inside. So you also have to keep in mind what the rules of the contest are and if your piece is going to work for it or if you should just do it for another convention.
And some of them will actually flip up your seams.
I do. I ask it of every single person that I judge if I can touch their costume and I can look at their seams.
Yeah, I mean, they won't ask you to take the shirt off so they can see the insides
oh,
of
no.
it.
Oh, no.
So I just wanted to clear that up. They won't actually ask for that. They won't ask you to take things off that you shouldn't. But, you know, judges may ask, you know, can I see the insides of your cuffs to see if you actually finished off the insides?
Mm-hmm.
You know, can I lift up the hem of your shirt so that I can see that your seams are nice and finished?
Mm-hmm.
They'll ask, and they'll look. You can tell them no, but...
Oh, yeah. I've had judges who've actually asked me to take off my gloves so they could see the inside when I say, yeah, I actually made these gloves myself. And they're like, really? Can we see them? Sure, here you go. So... They will, and we will ask.
And some of them just do it to admire the work. I mean, they may not be
oh, yeah.
they may not be distrusting of you when you say that I made these. They're not like, I don't believe you. Let me see. No, some of them just genuinely want to admire your work. So don't be offended if they ask. Is all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm. It's part of the process. So go with it, people. But yes, right. We're not going to tell you to strip. I promise. I promise.
Yes, please don't.
I say, do we want to maybe move forward into how the judging process works? Because there's one thing that I saw Benny pull it up, and I was actually going to go
I
into
see
it.
that. Also, the Facebook posting too.
Oh, yeah, true.
But actually, what I wanted to get into in general was what you do up on stage.
Oh, okay.
I mean, do you, oh, the judging, prejudging. Okay.
Prejudging.
Okay, yeah, let's do that first. I was thinking judging like afterward.
Oh,
No, no.
no.
Let's finish off prejudging.
Yeah. So one thing that Benny brought up, and which is I was also going to say, is practice what you're going to say to the judges. Because you usually only have 3 to 5 minutes to speak to them, even if you're in a large group. So you need to be able to convey everything that you've done with this costume in as few words as possible while giving them enough time to actually come up and check your costume. So think about what you want to say, take the time, look into a mirror, and practice, practice, practice. You're going to feel really silly doing it, and that is totally okay. But you're less likely to screw up in what you're going to say to the judges if you practice. Also, pro tip, please do not say what you're going to say to the judges in character. It is highly annoying, and I can never figure out what the heck your craftsmanship is if you're talking like Scooby-Doo. Okay, so please don't do that. Just be normal. You can act when you're on the stage. When you're in front of the judges, just be normal.
It's kind of like a really short job interview in a
Oh,
way,
absolutely.
as they're basically just probing you to see, what you did. It's similar to your portfolio, but verbal. And so in that way, it's a lot shorter because, they might pick up your portfolio and leaf through it, but they're not necessarily going to read every single word, but they do listen to every single word that you're actually saying to them.
Absolutely.
Another tip as far as talking to the judges, actually two of them. One is if you have a partner, come up with questions that they might potentially ask you so that you're prepared. Because one of the worst things that can happen to you is that they'll ask you a question you're completely unprepared for and you don't know how to answer it and you just, take up time trying to think of an answer. You kind of have to think real quick because, like Val said, you have 3 to 5 minutes. That's it. If you make a mistake, well, you just go with it.
As they, if you 3 to 5 minutes, 60 people to go through. Yeah, they want to get you in out as fast as possible.
And speaking of mistakes, as far as talking to judges about mistakes you made in your costume, it's generally not a good idea to emphasize them, even though, mistakes are a learning experience, or at least they're supposed to be. And you can actually use that as an example if they prompt you about it, or if it was a particularly meaningful learning experience to you. But otherwise, generally, rule of thumb is to not volunteer any mistakes you've made while making the costume. You want to emphasize the good, not the bad, but it's not that you want to avoid the bad. You just don't want to emphasize it is all. So, like for example, on the UA costume I have hanging up right here on my closet door, it's stained, and the stains are visible if you know where to look. So obviously, I'm not going to volunteer that the costume is stained, but if asked about it, then I will tell them why and what happened and what I learned from it. But otherwise, I'm not going to suddenly, get up and say, "Yeah, well, I was really disappointed because I stained my costume while I was making it." Yeah, you don't want to do that.
Yeah, judges want to see a cosplayer who's confident and who loves their costume. If they hear somebody talking about all the mistakes that they made, that they really didn't learn anything, that they hate what they're wearing, we're going to be more inclined to be like, well, why is this person even here? Why are they even putting in the effort? Versus somebody who's boasting about all the things they loved about their costume. Yeah, there might be one or two mistakes, and if, we point it out to them, they'll probably be like, yeah, okay, I own up, I made a mistake here. But if they love their costume and they're confident about it, we're more likely to respond positively towards them. So just think in the positive. Think of all the good things about your costume. Don't focus on the negative.
It's a lot about impression. It's what impression do you leave them with? Because when you're on stage, you don't get to talk to the judges. You get that 3 to 5 minutes beforehand, and that's it. So you want to leave them with a good impression for when they see you up on stage later on.
Exactly.
And speaking of up on stage, eventually you do have to go up on stage, unless you're doing hall cosplay. So as far as getting up on stage goes, at least as far as most conventions in a general sort of sense, you have a rehearsal beforehand where they will show you the stage. A lot of times they will have spaces marked off on stage, which are photo points, which are basically places that they want you to stop so that you can have your photo taken by the photographers that are all sitting in the press pit right in front of you. If you have stage fright, try not to focus on the photographers themselves or on the bright lighting or anything. And we'll get to that part. But, you know, just make sure that you stop where they tell you to stop, and they will let you practice walking across the stage so that you, you know, get a feel for how it's going to work. Generally, rehearsals, they'll try and move you real quick. Because when you walk across the actual stage, I think most places limit is 30 seconds.
Yeah, it's usually 30 to 60 seconds for a person or a group.
And a lot of times they will provide their own music for you to walk across to. It's usually some generic soundtrack, you know, pertinent to whatever kind of convention you're at. So, I mean, you can walk to the music if you want to. Sometimes that can help with stage fright, actually, if you focus more on the music than on what you're doing, you know, as far as flashing lights goes. But they will have that as a sort of aid to help with pacing. And also the announcer can help, too, because the announcer will kind of verbally gently move you along if you're taking too long.
Mm-hmm.
So just something with that. Then you end up thinking about posing, because obviously you're going to have to get up on stage. Usually they'll tell you to stop two or three times. Some cosplayers I have seen only stop once. Some cosplayers I've seen not stop at all.
Stop at all?
I have literally seen people walk straight across the stage and not stop, which, you know, it's fine if that's what you want to do, but part of the point of doing this and walking across a stage is because you want to display your work for the world to see. And, you know, it's nice to have pictures taken of that. Well, if you want to make a photographer's life easy, stop. You know, it's a lot harder to take a picture. As we both know, working with photography and videography, it's a lot harder to take a picture and video of a moving object that does not stop than it is for one that does.
Blurry cosplayer effect. Whee! Yeah, see, we don't like this. This is horrible.
Exactly. So you do want to stop and give the photographers time to capture your costume in the best light. So do think about what sort of a pose you would like to have photographed for your character. And then make sure that you actually stop and do that pose. And then move on.
See, I call this the 3-10 rule, which is basically three poses, one pose every 10 seconds, giving you a full 30 seconds, and that's including walking. And you just stop in the position that you need to, you mentally count to 10, which is usually a little faster than the real 10 seconds, move to the next spot, count to 10, third spot, count to 10, then you can exit the stage. That'll give you plenty of time to showcase your costume, and it's only 30 seconds, so you figure 30 seconds, I'm on there and I'm off. Even if you have stage fright, that's pretty quick. I mean, you're not going to get too freaked out by that. So.
And granted, you don't have to use all 30 seconds if you don't want to. It's not mandatory. That's just your maximum. So if you only use 20 seconds for three poses, that's cool.
That's fine. It's mostly we just want you to stop and pose so people can actually see your costume.
Right. And speaking of costume, I'm actually going to get up here for a moment so that we can kind of demonstrate a little bit of this. And Val's going to critique while I'm doing this.
Cool.
So if you will talk for a moment, I'm going to rotate my webcam around so that I can actually stand and do this. So talk a little bit about actually what you're doing and what you should think about when you're coming up with poses for your character.
Talking time for Val. Yay, I know this is very rare for me. Actually, there's one thing I did want to point out, and I don't think we're going to get to this later, so I'll say this now. I learned this from the WonderCon costume director, is that the contest itself is not just about you, it's about the audience, too. They're coming in so that way they can see a show. So you got to put on a show. That's important, too. So think about it not just from your perspective as I want to show off my costume, but that other people want to see a show. They want to see you be that character. So put in the effort to pose and stop and not be blurry. Please don't be blurry. Are you ready, Amber?
Yeah, I'm trying to get the right perspective on the camera so that you can get the most of my body that you can, because obviously I can't get a full body shot, but this way you can get, like, the most, and that you can still kind of hear me, because I do have a really long headphone cord on, but my mic is actually, like, over by the camera, so, you know, I may have to project a little bit more, or I may just not speak at all and just let you critique.
I was going to say, you're projecting really well, so you're good.
It's the teacher part of me.
Yeah, exactly.
The first thing that a lot of modelers will tell you to do, I know that Yaya is really big on this, is to do something with your hands. Because if you're just standing like this in a shot, this is what they call the basic frontal. You're not doing anything. It's just, it's basically like an actor's headshot where you're not doing anything. It's not, there's no movement to the picture. And photographers, if they want to show off your costume in the best light, would like some sort of movement to work with, something that portrays an emotion or a story kind of thing in a picture. So even if you're doing something as simple as putting your hands on your hips, you know, that
is instantly a million times better.
Right. And something else that you can do is think about what you're trying to portray if you have your hands on your hips. If you're trying to portray something a little sassy, then you may want to canch your hip a little bit.
Or even stick one of your legs forward and pop your hip just a smidge, and then you've got even more sass going on there.
Right. Plus, it affects your balance, too, and how you stand.
Absolutely.
So you can also do typical character poses. Like, if your character does the victory sign a lot, then you may want to have that as one of your trademark poses because it makes your character recognizable. I know that a lot of characters do that.
Mm-hmm.
Or they'll do some sort of caramel dancing-looking thing. You know, so if your character happens to have a pose, then do that. If your character has long hair, I mean, it doesn't have to be naturally long like mine. It can just be a wig. But you can sit there and do something with your hair. You know, that
adds
interest.
Oh, God, please don't do that with long hair. Oh, it would tangle so badly.
Well, you probably don't want to do it with my length of hair, which... Sadly, for the listeners who don't know, I am getting my hair cut on Tuesday, so it will actually be about as short as Val's. And it's entirely for health reasons, and I'm going to cry when they do it, but I have to do it. So this is kind of like my last...
No crying.
This is my last hurrah with excessively long hair.
No crying in baseball.
You know, if you have hair of an appropriate length, then you can just do something, you know, as simple as this.
Yeah. Very few cosplayers actually play with their hair, so that would be nice to see a little bit more of it. So there are some characters who do.
And this goes for both women and men.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, if you want to sit there and just do this, you know, with your hand kind of half running through your hair, that's cool, too. You know, it's just something that adds interest. And you can do kind of more intimate poses, like putting your hand up and then having maybe the other one on your leg.
Saucy.
Right. You're just trying to portray a certain kind of je ne sais quoi to the photographer and thus to your audience. Val, I hope you're monitoring comments because I can't see anyone doing this.
Yeah, I am. I just refreshed it. Okay. Nothing yet. I'm trying not to giggle at you.
Just making sure.
You're good.
Okay. That aside, also there are things that you can do with your face and especially with your neck. And this is something where... You know, the whole practice in front of a mirror thing really becomes evident. You will find really quickly that doing certain poses make you look less good in photography. I can't think, I'm looking for a word and I can't, less attractive.
Less attractive is probably the best way of putting it.
Okay, that's where I was trying to go with this.
Because everybody has a bad side, everyone has a bad pose, everybody has a little bad something. Even myself, and I know I'm a fairly thin person, but if there's certain ways that I tilt my head or I scrunch my neck, it makes my chin look like I have a double chin going on. It happens to everybody.
Exactly. Or if you know that you have an oddly shaped nose, or like in my case, I have a really long neck, so I may want to tilt my head slightly to make my neck look less long. No, it's all about perspective.
Exactly.
And if the photographer is experienced, they'll know to move themselves around to a better perspective without you having to actually like move. But not all photographers know to do that. So you may have to do some adjusting to make yourself look better. And to do that, you have to have a mirror. Or in my case, a secondary monitor and a webcam.
Yeah. Especially in the case for a cosplay contest where the photographers are kind of stuck in a small little area and they really can't move around, they're going to snap whatever they can get. So try to think of poses that are going to be generic enough that you know that they're going to be flattering for you, but they still add some interest and they're still dynamic and unique.
Right. And just bear in mind that whenever there is a press pit, usually they're on one side of you. So most of the time, they're not going to get a frontal shot. So just something to think about. If you actually have a prop with your costume, like this one I've conveniently placed next to me, this can make your photo a lot more interesting because now you have something with which you can move in the picture. It doesn't have to be a sword. It can be any number of things. It can be a flower. You know, it can be a yaoi bat, if that's what your character does.
It could be a giant snake.
It can be a cookie. Basically, you just want to add interest to your picture because now you have something on which you can focus. Plus, it gives your hands something to do. It looks more interesting. One of the things to think about if you are posing with a prop is to make sure the picture has the correct perspective on the prop. If I take a picture like this, you aren't seeing any of the detail on my sword, right? All you see is just the side profile of it. This isn't very flattering to all the work you did on your sword. So if you know that there's, you know, one particular side of your prop or one particular edge that should be seen, make sure it can be seen in the picture, especially if you're walking across the stage and you haven't been prejudged and you want the judges to see it. You know, you want them to see all the work you've done. This can also help if your character has trademark poses with a prop. So if your character, you know, does this, make sure that...
Move your sword down a little bit. It's covering your face.
Exactly. That's my point. You know, this is why you practice in a mirror. Because not only do you want to see the prop, we want to see you too.
We care about your face. This is the money. Okay, I have to pull a Tyra Banks here on America's Top Next Top Model, okay? We don't care about your body. This is the money. This is where you make all your cash. We care about this. So if we can't see this, you ain't getting paid.
Right, especially if you've done makeup for your character, like if you've colored your eyebrows, and especially if you're cosplaying, if you've made the effort to make yourself look like the other gender, you want that to come across because you did all this work, you know, show it off. If it's a little bit different if you have a prop that involves one hand, because then you need to make sure you're doing something with your other hand, even if it's just, you know, sitting here and grabbing the other end of the prop with your hand. You know, you don't want to have, okay, there's not a nice way of saying this without it sounding kinky.
Uh-oh.
Hands. You don't want to have hands that aren't doing anything.
No idle hands.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, that is what I meant to say.
You're welcome.
Yes, so you can have a one-handed prop, or walk over here and grab this one.
Or you can be like me, because I don't usually have a lot of props, so I tend to be prop and sword and staffless most of the time.
Or you can have two. And then, of course, you can always do the whole, you know, two prop poses. But again, make sure it does not cover the face. And make sure it actually shows the props if you have detail work on them. Because judges do want to see that. Judges actually do care about props. Even though it may seem that they're kind of a throwaway part of your costume, judges actually do pay attention to your props if you make them.
Sometimes the props can make the costume.
Or break it.
Exactly. It goes both ways.
Right. So, of course, if you're walking across the stage, you know, they announce your name. Say, yay, applause, applause, applause. So you walk over to the first marker, do your pose. At least hold it for 3 seconds. Give the photographer the chance to take your picture.
See, there's a reason why Amber keeps saying photo, and this is something to kind of keep in mind here. the judges and the photographers are basically in the same area, the same eye level. If the photographer can't capture you, the judges can't see you either. So you have to think about it from a photographer's perspective. If they can't see you, judges can't see you. That means exactly. The audience can't see you either. So exactly. It's always important.
Exactly. And it's something to think about as you're doing your poses, is am I doing a pose where the judges can see me and not cover, you know, important things up that you want them to see? So, you know, you do your first pose, go over to the second point, do your second pose, wait. If you have a third pose, third section, do your pose, and then you can walk off stage. And if you want to kind of give a nod of acknowledgement to the judges, you can. Doesn't hurt anything. And then, you know, you go back and you sit at your seat. There is no talking to the judges when you're walking across the stage. Everything is entirely nonverbal, so a lot of what they pay attention to, aside from the detail in your costume and props, is body language. And they're very good at picking up on confident cosplayers versus cosplayers that aren't. And I don't mean that in a stage fright sort of sense. It's more of, am I confident enough in the work that I have done that I feel that I deserve to be up on the stage? I guess, does that make sense?
It does. It's one of those where this is where acting as your character, or even acting not as the complete opposite of your character, really comes into play. You want to exude so much confidence that even if you're freaked out about your costume being really, really crappily, if you just know how to fake it all the way from up the stage to when you exit, you're going to feel a million times better. The judges are going to love you even more. Plus, most conventions now have a runway walk award, and a lot of times I see those go to people who have the zaniest walks or who are so ridiculously confident it's crazy, but maybe not the best craftsmanship for a costume. So it's something to think about. And I know another thing I want to bring up, because Benny also mentioned this in the chat
Thank
room
you.
Too. Yeah, you're welcome. Another thing that I wanted to bring up is how you walk across the stage, because the in-between moments from the moment that you step on the stage and you go to your first pose, the actual walk itself, can also affect your character. Not many people think about the way their character walks, but in a lot of animes, video games, whatever the case may be, some characters have distinctive walks. And those in-between moments can really help define your stage presentation. So you really want to take the time and think about, okay, not how am I posing, but how am I going to walk from point A to point B? How am I going to move this way or that way? I know Benny says that she likes to dance across the stage, and that's basically how she moves in her kimonos, is she's literally gliding and dancing across, and it makes it even more beautiful to watch her as she's presenting herself. So you have to think about, I know it's a lot of little things to think about, guys. I am so sorry. I'll post a link to my anime fest on cosplay competitions, because that panel is basically, here's everything you need to know, and then some. And me acting like a total fool.
This is kind of the in-brief version.
Yeah, the very, Although, very mini
also
version.
Also, the dynamic between individual cosplayers and a group cosplay is very different, because if you have a group cosplay going across the stage, you actually have more of an opportunity to interact with each other. And I know that last year there was a Black Butler duo that actually did a very graceful presentation of their costumes. This was a walk-on. This wasn't a skit. But they did almost a 30-second skit.
It really felt like
serving of tea.
Mm-hmm.
And one served to the other, you know, pretended to drink it, set it back down, they bowed to each other, and they went. And, you know, it was a very graceful presentation of their costumes, for one, but for two, it also gave something interesting to watch. It wasn't just somebody walking across the stage and posing, you know. It was interacting both with each other and with the audience.
Exactly.
Which can be really helpful when you're going for something like audience participation, because judges do actually listen to which ones the audience likes. Which, I know it's a myth that the most popular ones always win. That doesn't necessarily happen, but the judges do give some weight to what the audience thinks, and if you have two very equal costumes that you can't decide between, that can be the icebreaker. So you do want to actually, you know, interact, get the audience involved, you know, because you want them to appreciate the cosplay as much as you do.
Yeah. It's a show for them, too. That's why most
conventions... It's supposed to be fun.
Yeah. That's why most conventions now have, like, a runway walk or, like, a walk-on award just for, you know, who gave the best presentation.
I have to admit, I do remember a couple of years ago, Old Spice Guy.
Last year?
That must have been it. Simplest costume ever. Literally, it was a hotel bath towel and sandals.
Yeah, last year.
But he won a judge's award because the audience liked it so much. And his interaction with the audience as he was posing, you know, gave that extra charisma so that you really felt like, you know, you should like the costume as much as he obviously did. It's a lot more memorable that way. And when you're being judged against 60 other people, you want to be memorable. Because then you have a better chance of actually, you know, winning something. I know competition isn't only about the awards. I know Benny actually mentioned this on Facebook. Realistically, the attitude that you go into a competition with isn't, I deserve an award. I must have an award. It's not that you go in thinking that you're going to win something just because either you're you or because it's a particular costume.
Right.
You can go in thinking you are worthy to win. You can certainly go in thinking, you know, feeling that you're worthy to walk that stage. That's a healthy feeling to have, actually, because you want to be proud of the work that you've done. And you should feel like you deserve to walk across the stage. But the awards are a completely different matter.
Mm-hmm.
And you kind of have to have a healthy dose and a balance between confidence and humility, especially if you end up losing. Because you really don't want to be the one that's the bad sport. And yeah. We'll talk about that when we get to the judging. But honestly, the only other thing I can think of is just addressing stage fright. And the only way that you can really address stage fright in competition is, one, when they have a catwalk or when they have a non-stage cosplay event running that's kind of a practice, do those. Participate.
You have to practice, practice, practice. It's one of those things that you're not going to really get over until you get out there and do it, unfortunately. I hate to say that. And I'm weird because I have what I like to call reverse stage fright. You can stick me in a room with like 40,000 people. I can give a speech. No problem. You stick me in a room that has like two people that's like this big. I will freak out like crazy because I can see their eyes and I can see them judging me. So it's one of those things where you're not going to get comfortable with your stage fright until you're out there doing it. And I know that can be a killer and a crusher for some people, but that's the only way you're going to move past it. Start out with smaller conventions. Go to the ones like AllCons, for example, only has like maybe 100 people that can fit in the room. Start with smaller conventions. Start working your way up, because as you start doing it more and more, you're going to get comfortable with your stage fright.
Right. And you're honestly never going to get over it if you never do it.
Exactly.
Small convention or big convention, it doesn't matter. Eventually, you have to convince yourself to take that first step. And honestly, we know how scary that can be. We've done it. We've been there. And it still can be scary, even for the most experienced of cosplayers. You can still get anxiety across the stage. Heaven knows I still do every time.
I did when I did my Knights costume at Anime Matsuri last year. I was freaked out because that's something, a character type that I've never done before. So it happens to everybody.
Plus, you really can't get freaked out by the audience reaction. I mean,
absolutely.
You may have an audience that just doesn't seem to really go for your costume compared to others.
Mm-hmm.
You can't get discouraged by that. You honestly can't, because, you know, they're going to applaud what's popular. And cosplaying something that may not be as popular does not make you any less good than those others. So don't judge yourself based on the audience reaction alone. You know, if you are worthy enough to walk that stage, then you should hold your head high and not worry about it. Because you walked a stage, they didn't.
Yep.
And that's the difference. So with that serious note, let's move on to judging.
Oh, more seriousness. Yay.
Well, there is a little bit of seriousness when it comes to judging, although there is also a little bit of wackiness, because I guess the first thing to think about is that judges are people too.
We're humans.
And I know some of this is going to touch on, you know, Rose's entry into Facebook, judging from the judge's perspective.
Oh, right.
But I do know, if you don't have that pulled up yet, go ahead and do that.
I'm going to do that now. Keep talking.
You know, judges are human beings, so when they're judging costume contests, it's based on their own perspective, for one. And for two, it's based a lot on their own experience. Some judges actually do have degrees in a related topic, like fashion design, like theater, like, you know, sewing and textiles. Just because they don't doesn't necessarily make them less qualified to judge certain aspects of your costume. So don't necessarily go into the judging room thinking that just because you don't know who these judges are doesn't mean that they're not qualified, because that will bring you in with a really negative attitude to start with, and judges will really sense that, and you don't want to, again, leave a negative impression. So just, you know, go in there respectfully, job interview, you know, do your thing, and then same thing when you're on the stage. Still treat the judges with respect and don't walk across the stage thinking, they don't know what they're doing. They can't judge me. They're not qualified. No, you still have to be respectful because this is their show. They're the ones giving the awards. You should be respectful. Plus, they're donating their time to come and judge the contest. They don't have to do this. Some of them don't even get paid for it.
Yeah, it's definitely a difference between being respectful and being arrogant. You can maybe disagree with their choices, but you can still be respectful about it. Because I know that there are times when I sit in a contest and I'm like, really, we're picking this one because why? But I mean, we all have to be polite to each other. Because, I mean, it is just for fun. I mean, bottom line, we're dressing up as cartoon characters. Come on. It's supposed to be fun.
Right. When you do the stage walk, the judges are taking into account any prejudging that has been done. And, of course, they may have your portfolio with them to remind them briefly of what you did. But basically, the judges have to judge your work in 30 seconds. That's all they get. And they're judging it from their seat. They're not actually, like, up close and personal with you. So anything that they're judging is basically on face value and presentation. But that doesn't make it any less of a judging.
Right.
Because you can still see details from a distance, especially with all those stage lights on you. And I believe, you may have to verify this, but I believe they may go off of a point sheet.
Okay, it depends on the contest. Something like Costume Con, where it really is about craftsmanship, then yes, they do have a point sheet. Most anime conventions that I've been to or where I've judged at, we have like a generic tally sheet where we give a presentation on the stage, you know, okay, we'll give them an extra little bump here or a bump there. I know the way that I did it at NakaCon, they just gave us a stack of sheets with everybody's name and their costume on it, and we basically just said, okay, this one's a yes pile, this one's a no pile, and then we just whittled down from there. So there wasn't any points. It was just a matter of this is a yes, this is a no. So it's going to vary.
Right. There is some sort of ranking system that they are using to compare your costume with other costumes.
Yeah, it's not like an arbitrary system of like, oh, I like this anime, so therefore they're going to win. No. We do our best to try to remove all of our bias from it. We do take into consideration, you know, the craftsmanship level, how long they worked on it, what their detail is, and all that stuff. So it's purely from a crafting standpoint.
Something else, you know, to consider, both from a competitor's and a judge's perspective, when you're competing, is category. Not all conventions do this anymore. Some of them have basically eschewed this for just a general sort of, you know, competition.
Mm-hmm.
But some competitions will divide you up either by theme, if it's one of those general sort of things like Alcon, or they will divide you up, I don't want to say ability, because that's not fair. Level of craftsmanship.
There we go.
Is probably the most PC way of saying that. And I don't mean to denigrate people by saying that, because you can have masters who don't necessarily compete in that category. You can have beginners who don't necessarily compete in that category. Basically, when you're placed in those categories, you're either self-placed, where you tell them where you think you are, or they will place you in one.
I'm going to keep my hand raised because that's what happened to me.
Basically, the judges are doing that not because they're hateful people. They're doing that because they want to judge you against similar levels of cosplayer. They don't want to put a beginner against a master because that's not entirely fair. So they're trying to basically level the playing field by matching you against similarly abilityed people. Mm-hmm. So when you compete... Why is my computer... My computer's trying to scan itself all at once. It's like, no, stop.
Bad time to scan, computer.
Yes, bad time. So, you know, when you're placed in a category, just know that you will be ranked against people who are also in your category. And, of course, best in show, you're ranked against everybody.
Yeah. You can't get that one.
But, you know, judges will only judge you against your peers. Mm-hmm. Not against everybody if they are doing categories.
And categories so, can change from convention to convention, too. So it couldn't be, like, for one convention, a beginner is somebody who's never competed, but another convention, a beginner might be somebody who's been in two contests already. Or, like, a master's is somebody who's won 10 contests. And it's just, like, it's going to be arbitrary based on the convention. And a lot of times it'll just be you put down a category, and you could say you're intermediate, but the judges take one look at you and they're like, no, you're a master, and they'll immediately bump you. So it's pretty arbitrary sometimes, unfortunately.
That is definitely the case a lot of the time.
Oh, yes, there's a good one. Hang on. Benny made up a good point. I forgot about this. If you're in a group, usually it's based off of one person or two people in the group on what their highest standing is. So if you're a beginner and you have two people in your group that have competed at master's level, you're immediately going to all be in masters. So groups, you have to take that into consideration too.
Right. And I know that they'll also judge groups based on how, I don't want to say similar the costumes are, but that's basically like how thematic the costumes are if you're from the same series.
Right.
They'll give more points to a group whose costumes were clearly all made using the same materials and same techniques.
Exactly.
Even if they don't look the same. Than one that's a little bit more slapdash.
Exactly.
As a rule of thumb, generally, if you have won a few awards at any convention in cosplay, you're probably already intermediate or above.
Exactly.
So just think about that whenever you enter a costume contest, you know, they'll ask you what you think you belong in. Don't lowball it, because they'll look at you and they'll know pretty quickly. You know, you can't really fool judges, because even if they don't have industry experience in the textiles industry, they know. They've seen enough costumes to know. So, you know, don't try and lowball yourself. At the same time, you don't want to run the risk of highballing yourself either. Because Masters is hard, man.
Oh, man, Masters of the Bee.
If I haven't gotten bumped there by A-Kon this year, I will have been bumped there,
dude. Okay.
I think.
Good word of warning. If you ever win a Best in Show, you're immediately going to be bumped to Masters. Because you know what happened to me my very first contest? I freaked out after that because I was like, oh man, I'm a Masters for life and I've only been in this once. I was so freaked out at WonderCon because of that. I was like, well, what level are we putting you in? I'm also going to put beginner, but I just won a Best in Show. Crap. It sucks.
Yeah, and then, because this was actually addressed in the chat room as well, the aftermath of the judging. I hate to break this to the audience at large, but you're going to lose. At some point in your life, you are going to lose in a costume contest.
Tear.
So, one, internalize that now.
Yes.
Because it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And two, now that you've internalized that, and I'm not doing this to be facetious, I'm doing this, you know, to kind of be funny and serious in the same breath, you have to figure out how you're going to deal with that. Because you are going to have to deal with it, and you can either deal with it in a positive manner or you can deal with it in a negative manner. And I think we all kind of know what I'm talking about when I say the negative manner. We call them sore losers.
Yeah.
And let me say that being a sore loser in the cosplay fandom gets around.
Oh, quickly too.
You will have heard very quickly, probably by the end of the convention, before you even leave, if somebody was a sore loser at the contest, because cosplayers will tell. Because it's also, you know, it's seen in bad taste. And you don't want to sit there and bemoan it, for one. And two, realistically, blaming it on the judges is not the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
Because remember, judges are people. They have their opinions. They have their ranking sheets. They do not have to explain themselves to you. I will just say that up front.
No.
You can ask them why they judged the way they did, but they're not obliged to tell you. Nor should you bug them if they tell you no. Just saying. So accept their decision, because their decision is final. It kind of has to be, because you can't really go back and relitigate a costume contest. Basically, you want to take it as a learning experience in a humble sort of way, because that's the best way you really can take it. And if you do talk to the judges, because, you know, if they do choose to talk to you, you can learn from it, because you can learn how to improve. Not what you did wrong. That's not the way to look at it. Learn what you need to do to improve, to give a better impression next time. Quick story. I think it was last year when I competed at Project A-Kon. I lost.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the judges actually stopped me afterward. And I won't tell who it is, just to, you know, to be PC about it, I guess. No drama. But this person was like, you know, we very nearly gave you a judge's award just for the prop alone. But there were so many good costumes this year that we had a really hard time choosing. And I knew part of why I had lost was because part of my prop had broken. And I knew immediately that I should improve upon that for next year, and I have. I have fixed that problem for this year. So it's not, what did I do wrong? It's, what can I fix?
Mm-hmm.
And so I fixed that thing based on the feedback I got after the contest. And I know that, based on her commentary, that I was on the right track in terms of, you know, what I'm learning to do with my cosplay, the techniques I'm using, the level of care I'm putting into it. I knew I was on the right track. And just a word or two from a judge can really do wonders for a cosplayer's confidence. Not ego. Confidence.
Confidence.
Cosplayers have egos too, but that generally doesn't come from the judges.
We're totally ego-ridden. Well, I mean, you also have to think about, too, is that when you come across a situation, and this is being talked about in the chat room, like Matsuri, when I competed last year, everyone's costumes were so fantastic. They're just, of course, there's never going to be enough awards to go around. It doesn't necessarily mean that your costume was bad or there may have been anything wrong with it. It may have been that just somebody else did something a little bit different and a little bit better, or maybe your costume just didn't work within the criteria of that convention. Maybe if you moved it to so-and-so convention, you might win a huge award there. Because I know that's probably the situation with my Lady Lilith from last year from A-Kon. I knew flat out I wasn't going to win squat. I got a character that from a series that nobody gives two craps about, and it's Final Fantasy XI. No one cosplays from that but me. So I knew going into it I wasn't going to win squat. But if I go to a fantasy fair or if I go to a Final Fantasy thing, hell yeah, I'm going to win something.
I mean, even something as simple as the way you pose.
Yes, that can make a big
can
difference.
Make or break whether or not you actually win something. Because remember, you're showing your costume off to the judge. The better you show off your costume, the better your chances are of winning an award.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why posing can be really important, as can the prejudging and portfolio, and what you say to them in the room. All of it just kind of, you know, mixes together in this giant ball of cosplay dumb that is competition. And yeah, it's a lot to think about.
It really is.
I mean, if you look at competition now compared to where it was even 5 years ago, oh my God, costume competition is just fierce. I mean,
bananas.
The level of cosplay nowadays compared to where it was is just apples and oranges. It is insane
even
to compete.
For beginners.
Yes. I was going to say, it's insane to compete even at the lowest levels now of competition because cosplay as an art form has risen so high so quickly. Mm-hmm. Now, this is not to discourage people from joining at all. If you want to compete, go for it. No one's going to stop you except you.
Exactly.
And don't think that budget is going to stop you either, because some of the greatest costumes were made from parts found at garage sales and consignment stores.
No more than $100 right here. Woohoo!
Budget should not stop you from competing. Acknowledge that there will be work. If you want to compete and actually have a chance to win something, you're going to have to work
hard.
But that shouldn't stop you from wanting to compete. You know, if you want to do it, do it. Work hard, put in the time, put in whatever money is needed, do it, and walk across that stage with your head held high, because you deserve it.
That deserves a clap. That was brilliantly said.
Thank you.
Good job.
So, we will go out on a positive note, at least on our topic for today, and we've got a contest winner we need to announce, because we've made them wait long enough. Drum roll! Is there a little third party?
Wait, there should be. Hang on, let me get to the Google.
Where's the FX?
I know there is one.
Do the drum roll.
I know there is one. Keep talking.
This is for our contest that was sponsored by Epic Cosplay.
There we go.
Our winner is Clinton!
Yay!
Applause. Where's your effect? Thank you.
Thank you, Google.
Yes, congratulations to Clinton for winning our first ever trivia contest. We will probably be doing this again in the near future, possibly with other awards. We will see. But Clinton, send us an email to our podcast@cosplay.org address with your contact info so that we can get you in contact with Epic Cosplay and they can send you your $10 gift card.
Yay! Which I think, are they still having their sale? Or are they done with their sale?
They may still be having it.
So you might get something super cheap then.
Yes. They have had some actually really good, solid things on clearance. I mean, I don't need them at the moment, but that doesn't mean they're not good.
I know, that's my problem! I was like, I gotta think into the future, what do I need? But I don't need anything!
Exactly. So if you have a character you're thinking about doing in the future, but you know, I'm not quite ready for it yet, go ahead and get the wig if it's on sale, because you can save a lot of money. You can seriously save a lot of money that way. And Epic Cosplay, their quality has really gotten better from when they first started, you know, selling wigs.
Oh, I'm in love with my Raven wig. I mean, I got my Raven wig from them, and I've worn it the last 2 weekends, and I haven't lost a single hair yet, so I'm thrilled about that already, because it was windy as crap yesterday.
I like that their wigs, I mean, I know this is kind of like a giant commercial for Epic Cosplay, who is not,
yeah,
in fact, paying, it's not paying us anything to say this, I wish.
That'd be awesome.
Their wigs are getting a lot better about detangling, mm-hmm, after you've worn them, and that's actually a really big factor in general for cosplay wigs from any manufacturer. When you're done wearing them, you have to comb them just like normal hair, just not using the same technique as normal hair. Just saying. But you do have to brush them out to detangle them. And I see that our video has... Okay. Is our video still showing live for you?
Let me take a quick play button.
Because I'm not seeing the video on my actual, like, on-air broadcast screen. And that's... It just suddenly went out. That's why I'm asking. It's like,
hang
man,
on,
have we been talking
to catch up?
Have we been talking too long? We've already broken the video. But yes, as Benny says, Epic Cosplay will have a booth at A-Kon, should you wish to purchase wigs from them. Incidentally, pro tip, if you would like to detangle a wig and you do not wish to purchase actual wig detangler, one, do not use WD-40. Even though it may say it's silicone-based, you really don't want your wig smelling like that for the rest of its natural life.
Who recommends WD-40? What cracker?
I have seen it online that you can use it to detangle wigs. That smells. Use fabric softener. You just mix it half and half with water, put in squirt bottle, brush.
Oh my god, the smell. Especially if you Sharpie dyed it. Oh my god. Oh my god, that's a mess. Holy crap.
Some chemicals should not be mixed.
No, please do not.
Okay, so vid's still going. At least
okay,
I can
apparently Andrea's saying it's been going out a little bit every now and then.
Okay. I apologize on behalf of my internet service provider, whom I will not name, for having shared internet cable. Well, I'm a poor college student, that's what I can afford. What can I say? But, at any rate, Epic Cosplay is wonderful. So is EL Wire Pros, incidentally. PROS, as in professionals.
That's who I was trying to think of yesterday. I was trying to give them their info, and I was like, I don't remember the name of the website. Like,
if you need EL Wire for any reason, not only do they sell it in any feasible length, they will also sell you the inverter that goes with it. And their customer service is probably one of the best of any company, period, I've done business with, because they're very prompt, they're very polite, and they will tell you when something is not in stock. Even though it says back order on the website, if you order it anyway, they'll still call you and notify you. It's like, wow.
That's so nice of them.
You know, and again, they're not paying me for saying this. I just, you know, it's very difficult nowadays to find a company that you do business with on a semi-regular basis that is so prompt and polite and actually has a decent product for what you pay for it. Mm-hmm. For those who haven't seen on my DeviantArt, which I will be doing a new pick of this costume, when I feel like putting it all on. My UA is done, and I made his bow of light. And it is on my DeviantArt, and it is lit up in daylight, still brightly enough that you can see it lit, which is what I improved on from last year. They have a new line of EL wire that's 20% brighter. And yes, it is indeed 20% brighter. So, you know, I highly recommend EL Wire Pros, and you can always Google them, you know, for their store online. But now that our commercials are over... Those were unintentional commercials, by the way. So if you wanted to fast forward past those, then that's cool.
Yeah.
They're not actually sponsoring us. We just love them. we've got previews of Fanime, which Val
very,
is going
very
to.
Very quick.
And
I'll be
Project
there.
Project A-Kon!
No!
Which we'll do an after session.
No breaks for Val. She's got one this weekend, one next weekend, A-Kon after that. Yeah. I don't really have a preview because here's the problem. I still don't know what the crap I'm going to wear to Fanime. I know for certain, okay, not 100% certain, but I'm pretty certain that Friday will be Raven. I know 100% certainty on Saturday afternoon it'll be Rose from Street Fighter. I don't know what the hell I'm wearing the rest of the weekend. There's my preview. I get to spend the next 3 days trying to figure out what the crap I can stick into my luggage that TSA will not destroy. And then I'll be there from Thursday until Monday. Enjoy the wonderful weather that is in San Jose and praying that it is not humid. Because after this weekend, I want no humidity. There's my preview.
Okay, now my preview video has come back. Although it's not manually switching back and forth, so now I have to manually control it because it doesn't auto-switch anymore, which is what I was worried about. Darn it. So every time you talk, I'm going to have to switch it. It doesn't auto-switch for me anymore. But anyways, Project A-Kon preview. I'm teaching stuff, and we're recording stuff. I don't even know what to say about my costume lineup, because even that isn't set, and I know it's less than 2 weeks before the con, but I keep changing my mind, which I never, ever have done before. I have never changed my mind this close to the con. I've always had a very set costume lineup because I would have, you know, I have limited packing space. I can only take so much with me. But because the weather is supposed to be so odd this year, it's going to be hot, it's going to be humid, it's going to be windy at A-Kon.
Sounds like God.
So I'm sitting there going, okay, great. So it's an outdoor venue, primarily. The Anatolis, a lot of it's outside, especially for photography purposes. So it's like, okay, I want to wear as light a costume as possible. Light meaning lightweight, so I don't sweat to death. Even though it's an air-conditioned venue, there's going to be, you know, 23,000 people there. So there's going to be, you know, it's still going to be warm inside. So it's like, okay, I was going to wear Umi, Ryuzaki, Magic Knight Ray Earth, for those who don't know. And while that is a sleeveless costume, it's a layered costume and it involves armor. It's like, okay, well, I could wear that, or I could whiz through the remake of the corset for Athena from Saint Seiya. That would be a halter dress with an armored corset. Much lighter than Umi, but means it takes more work for me to actually like have it done in time for Con, which I probably wouldn't be able to finish it anyway at this point. So, you know, my lineup keeps changing. I will have Deedlit for sure. I will have Yue for sure. And then it's just a matter of Umi, Erza, or Athena, whichever gets done first, and which I feel like taking.
I know my A-Kon lineup. That one is 100% certain. I know exactly what I'm wearing, and what days I'm wearing it, even what times I'm going to be wearing these things. I don't think I've changed so much in costume so many times. So I'm not concerned about that. It's just Fanime. I tried to put thought into this. I really did, but somehow along the way, it just kind of got swept under the rug, and now I have no flipping clue what I'm bringing.
Also, A-Kon preview, let's see. My first panel I'm teaching is Friday. It's from 2 to 3 p.m. It is in Governor's Lecture Hall. I'm sitting here looking at the actual schedule in my hand, that's why I keep looking down.
Gotcha.
And that is costume armoring. I am teaching basically how to make, plan, and store your armor for any kind of genre, along with Pharaoh and Clover. So I will have sidekicks, I will have a dress form, we will actually sit there and form armor there in front of you so you can see it. We will bring many, many examples, at least as many as I can pack, given my expansive things that I have to pack. Okay, so that is my Friday panel. The schedule for A-Kon is really long.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, where's my Saturday?
Wait, we're still flipping. Hang on.
I just finished getting through Friday. I think it was 6 pages long. Okay. On Saturday, I am teaching creating and altering cosplay patterns. That is from 10:15 to 11:15, I think, if I'm reading this correctly. No, it's 10:30 to 11:30. I'm sorry. The schedule looks funny. It's 10:30 to 11:30 on Saturday. It's in the Metropolitan Ballroom, which is on the mezzanine level. And I will be teaching how to use commercial patterns, how to make your own via slopers and blocks, how to drape your own patterns, and how to do prop patterns. Then we are recording CosPod live! Yay! We're recording CosPod live! And that is the one that's at 11:15. Until 12:15, that is morning 11:15, not night 11:15. 11:15 in the morning, and that is in Governor's Lecture Hall. And we will be doing brief tutorials on cosplay photography while we are in there. We will try and do what interviews we can while we are in there, and we will also do our Project A-Kon review, because this is going to be episode 38, and we are recording it live at A-Kon.
Yay!
And basically, it will release as soon as we collapse from exhaustion after Project A-Kon. Because, yeah, I have to go back to work the Monday after A-Kon, and that's first of the month accounting for me.
I took Monday off. However, I am going to be dead. So just assume the episode will not be ready until, like, the end of the week, maybe?
Oh, also, I think it was Clinton that had asked about streaming panels live from A-Kon.
Oh, right.
Unfortunately, that will not happen because A-Kon did not pay for free Wi-Fi in public areas. At least that's what I read on their Facebook. So because there isn't enough range for me to reach their public Wi-Fi that's in the restaurants, the quality would be poor enough from my laptop that the stream wouldn't even be worth watching. So unfortunately, it's looking like we're not going to be able to live stream the panels from A-Kon. You know, as unfortunate as that is, so you won't get to see them recorded. And basically, I'm going to spend the entire week after A-Kon, after I'm done collapsing, releasing vids as fast as humanly possible.
We'll do our best.
Which, given that the cosplay track is insanely full this year, I think all in all, I have something like 15 or 20 panels on my filming docket for A-Kon already. So there will be an insane number of panels for release. I will get to them as fast as I can, but please at least give me 24 hours off to collapse and rehydrate myself and recoup some of my lost sleep and some of my lost food. And rest my aching feet from standing for 10 to 12 hours a day for 3 days straight. And lugging around 40 pounds worth of filming equipment in a luggage bag. In cosplay, no less.
In cosplay.
I'm going to be a real trooper. I'm going to be in cosplay and filming.
Woo-hoo.
And I'm going to have to switch cosplays. Because, I guess we can cover this in the after session. Yeah, so it's going to be a busy, busy next 2 weeks for the two of us. So if for some reason we're not quite as active online as we normally are, it's not because we're ignoring you. We love you all, and we hope that you're still listening to the show after hearing us ramble for an hour and a half. It's because we're trying to get ready for two cons over 2 weekends.
Oh, my head's already hurting thinking about it.
With that, we will end this episode 37 on competition. As always, if you have any questions, comments, complaints, concerns, suggestions, contact us through any of our social media on DeviantArt, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, or you can email us at podcast@cospod.org. You can also find the complete guide to A-Kon if you need it on our homepage, which is cospod.org. You can download any of the files there for your viewing pleasure. And other than that, we will see you at Project A-Kon live for episode 38. Bye, guys.
Bye.